I'll try to keep this introduction short if I can, but tonight I get the honour of introducing Ron Manners. Ron Manners is the Managing Director of the Man West Group, a family-owned business that has been serving Australia's mining industry since 1895, which is 6 years before Australia had a flag or a constitution. His accomplishments were actually recognised in 2005, where he was inducted as a mining legend. Ron Manners was introduced to the free market movement in 1952 by Leonard E. Reed, and since then he has kept an active interest in the free market through the Manpower Economic Education Foundation. Since its founding, he has sponsored over 600 students to internships and conferences around the world, including myself, which is why I'm here doing an internship at the Lion Rock Institute as a manpower scholar. In addition to that, he is a talented author, and for two lucky guests, they can actually purchase a twin set of his books at the counter right at the front, so get on it. Ron tonight has actually shared some experiences with Milton Friedman himself, including a couple of meetings. I think one in 1978 in Hong Kong and in 2001 in San Francisco. So he will be sharing his experiences with us now.
Folks, thanks for being here. Someone talking about writers, someone asked a famous writer recently what is the secret of his success. And he said he just simply cuts out the bits that people are going to skip anyway. Well, I've tried to do that tonight because so much has been written about Milton Friedman that I'll just try to cut it right down. Now, first of all, what the hell is an Australian mining explorer doing here in Hong Kong talking about an internationally renowned economist like Milton Friedman? Well, the answer is simple. Those in the back would like to hear perhaps too. The answer is simple. There is one binding theme that links mining exploration together with economics, and in fact, all human intellectual pursuits and even all successful careers. It's best expressed by the words of the Hungarian physiologist who was awarded the Nobel Prize in Medicine in 1937. His name was Albert Szent-Györgyi, and he put it this way. Discovery consists of seeing what everybody has seen and thinking what nobody has thought. For instance, a mere spectator will see the latest smartphone and simply say, isn't that great? But an entrepreneur will say, how can we make that better? It's just a different attitude. When you think about Albert's words and the true meaning of seeing what everyone has seen and thinking what nobody has thought before, you get a clear understanding between a good economist and an average politician, for instance. A good economist will see the long-term damage to flow from bad policy. But a politician will only see hopes and expectation. On average, our average politician fears when the economy starts falling over. But a good economist asks, why is the economy falling over? Because he knows what policy needs to be taken to solve the problems. Who knows when government spending runs up above 25% of GDP, your economy is in trouble. Like France at 50%, the most of Europe at 40%, and the US very close behind. How about the Australian versus the Hong Kong figures? It just happened to happen. The percentage in Australia of government expenditure on the GDP is 32%. Hong Kong, only 23%. Big difference. Interestingly enough, it correlates to the numbers of the cities and the population that's employed by the government. in Australia, it's 8.2% are employed by the government. In Hong Kong, 3.8%. So we can level up. And they've got quite good economists with an absolute clear understanding of these, the relevance of those statistics, was Milton Friedman. Let me mention that also, Professor Milton Friedman always gave credit to his famous economist wife, Rose. And she jokingly claimed half of his Nobel Prize when it was awarded to him. With parents like Milton and Rose Friedman, it's no wonder that they've got a brilliant son called David Friedman, a fantastic economist, and grandson, Patrick Friedman, who's following the same trail. It's in the genes. Milton Friedman changed the world by using relentless and always polite persuasion to bring about focused challenge for us. He abolished wage and price controls in many countries. The legislation of private gold ownership in about 1972 rested largely with Milton Friedman, has pointed out the nonsense of preventing making it illegal for us people to own gold. Years have gone by, we forget that we couldn't own gold. He steered through dramatic tax reductions, he ended the military conscription in the US, and his theory of consumption function fundamentally underlined changes in economics. Friedman's economics worked because he himself had actually worked. He rejected the ideas that worked only in smart men's minds, but failed in worthy men's lives. Author Daniel Friedman said once, "Fellow economists laughed at me." That was before the 1970s, laughed back at them. He debated adversaries with unfailing patience and graciousness. It was often said that economists like to debate with Milton, particularly when he was not there. My favorite two Milton Friedman books was Capitalism and Freedom. Capitalism Freedom contains all the theories of Friedman, all the theories that were stressed during his career as a public intellectual, emphasized almost every page the inseparable link between economic and political theories. This other book that I love is Free to Choose, the book that accompanied the 10-part TV series by the same name. Now, what did Queen Elizabeth say to Milton Friedman as Friedman's board of the Royal Yacht Britannica in San Francisco Harbor? It was, "Oh, I know you. Philip is always watching you on the telly." Prince Philip is still a great fan of Milton Friedman's pre-produced TV series, which has had tremendous impact all around the world. And even in Perth, we run an American Foundation runners and annual conference with the Dr. Miami University by the same name, Fred Chills. A year before Milton Friedman died, Stephen Moore of the Wall Street Journal asked him, "Milton, what can we do to make America more prosperous?" He replied, "Three things. Promote free trade, promote school choice, all children and cut government spending." "How much should we cut?" said Moore. "Freedom," said, "as much as possible." That's a nightmare in Hong Kong. It's a city that Milton Friedman loved almost as much as he loved his life drugs. I met Milton Friedman here in 1978. So first let me explain how I read Milton Friedman's words some 5 years before then. Has anyone heard of Hugh Hefner's Playboy magazine? Has anyone read it for the articles? Well, I have a lot to thank Playboy magazine for. Four things, and I just thought of a fifth one, but four things. In the first issue in 1953, Playboy magazine introduced the world to Marilyn Monroe. The second book, in a 1960 issue, a series of articles by Hugh Hefner titled The Playboy Philosophy introduced me to philosophy and led me to enroll as an external student at the University of West Australia, and I studied philosophy one. Professor John Hosters of the University of Minnesota in Southern California was the author of Introduction to Philosophical Analysis. And the textbook we studied from this led me to a lifelong friendship with Hosters himself until his death at age 93 in 2011. Hosters was a member of Ayn Rand's group, they jokingly called the collective, along with Alan Greenspan and a remarkable collection of people. Then in 1972, Hosters ran as the Libertarian president in the US, actually got a vote. The third thing was the issue featured in Playboy in 1964, an interview with Ayn Rand. That actually introduced me to her influential book, Atlas Shrugged. It's amazing, there's a thread running through all this. And then in 1973, there was the famous Playboy interview with Milton Friedman. Although I'd heard of Friedman before 1973, due to his relationship with several US think tanks, I was not fully absorbed his wisdom, but it was his punchy style in that Playboy interview that prepared me for his probing curiosity and questioning that I had to endure the several occasions that I spent in his company. Now, I have a yellowing copy of that Milton Friedman 1973 interview for some lucky individual who would ever like to claim it, but it's absolutely collector's item. So, anyone would like this? Oh, exactly.
We've got a speaker over here. I'll be present.
Okay. And I'll see it on tag from way back. A wonderful question. Playboy asked, I said, Milton, are there any government programs that's just successfully approved for a lot of people? Check his answer. At one meeting, I presented Milton Friedman with a copy of this document called In Support of Free Enterprise. It was produced by the Chamber of Commerce, and it was really an analysis of how supportive Western Australia was of the free enterprise system. He later wrote me a wonderful congratulatory letter that made me feel very bad because I played no part in preparing this. But it did prove to him, proved to me, that he read every word of that book. And he read references and he was most impressed. Now, that wasn't bad for a guy who was a week away from his 19th birthday. So I thought it was a busy guy, but it took the time to right, because he really liked how we were there for the dear and the rest. So anyway, tonight's 101st birthday party for Milton here in Hong Kong is about personal revolutions. And I'll see you on one particular occasion when I was invited to the 20th anniversary of the Atlas Economic Research Foundation held in San Francisco in May 2001. One evening of that Atlas event was called an evening with Milton and Rose Friedman and it formed part of the 90th birthday celebrations for Milton. Apart from his own presentation and congratulatory speeches from a number of people around the world, several of us think tank directors had the opportunity to have our little 10-minute session with Milton. So we all had our little list of questions to ask the Professor Friedman's focus earlier that evening was on money being too important to be left with separate bankers, and said you essentially have a group of unelected people who have enormous power to affect the economy in one way or another. And Milton was floating a theory to abolish the Fed and just replace it with a personal computer. in its essence, the PC would determine the economy's budget and basically consist of the increase of, well, say, 3% annually to keep up with the expected growth in population and production. Probably a very vertical alternative. So why have focused on asking people what he regarded as his priority challenges, as you do when somebody is approaching their birthday. So what are your real challenges? He said, yes, with a smile, to the mental effect, yes, as Bill said earlier, well, now everyone should know that inflation is in the long run almost everywhere, and monetary phenomenon is playing all that down. So I'm focusing on competition in education. He explained how the Friedman Foundation was set up to study this issue as they were totally against the idea of governments running the schools and allocating places primarily on the address of where those students live. Didn't have any sense of liberty. His comments to me were like this. The government has to subsidize anybody at all. It should be the customers, that's the parents and the children, but never the producers, that being the schools and their highly unionized teachers. Something empower the customers, he said, and create competition and they will achieve much better results. Purpose of having three choices without competition can allow the educational system to get out of the 17th century and into the 21st century. Now, those of you who result of the Friedman Foundation work, 13 US states and Washington, D.C. have adopted school choice programs and expanded existing laws and the more methods continue to do. And in my own personal opinion, if that momentum continues for 100 years, what will people's career, this life will be touched, this contribution to revolutionizing education. Now, conclusion. On every one of those occasions that I was involved with Milton Friedman on this presentation, I noticed that he always insisted on having the last word. Whatever somebody said, Milton would have put back and always had the last word. So, in the case of my colleague, D.Y. Murdoch, he had his little private session with me just before that came in. D.Y. concluded his session with my will. That's all of my questions. Thank you. Milton's response was, yes, maybe one of your questions, but it's certainly not one of my answers. In my case, I concluded my interview with the time with him by simply thanking him and then about to walk away. And he said, ah, just a minute. Do you know what this? He had a question. I was curious. So he had the last words with his scholarly artist profound words. You can answer the question with those words that I to yourselves, individually, as much as they have both of you. So, well, I can tell you that we both have happy childhoods. That is obvious to me, because a happy childhood lasts forever. So, thanks, folks.